Rule number one, never get between a man and his car. Christine tells the story of young high school nerd Arnie, who buys this old, rusted, decrepit Plymouth Fury. But as Arnie starts to restore this car, not only does he completely change his appearance and his demeanor, but numerous mysterious vehicular murders start to pop up around town. All right, people, leading up to the remake of It, which I am so excited for, I decided to go ahead and build up to that by doing a couple of reviews of my favorite Stephen King adaptations. And Christine is not only one of my favorite Stephen King adaptations, it's one of my favorite films by John Carpenter. It has always blown my mind how underrated I honestly believe this movie is. I run into so many people who have either never heard of it, never seen it, or have seen it but have completely forgotten about it, and it just blows my mind. I grew up with this movie, I always revisit it, and I always sing its praises whenever Stephen King or John Carpenter is the subject at hand. And John Carpenter himself doesn't necessarily get behind this movie like he does some of his other films that he's really passionate about, which is also really surprising to me. He's actually on record for saying that he only did this movie as a job. He did it for a paycheck. After the financial and the critical bomb that The Thing was, which is such a weird sentence to get behind, that The Thing was a critical and financial bomb, but nonetheless, that's a video itself. He wanted to do a movie just to get a paycheck to kind of replenish himself and to kind of get out of the slump that he was in after The Thing. And funny enough, the studio actually wanted to cast Brooke Shields and Scott Baio in the lead roles of Arnie and Lee in this movie, but the filmmaker, John Carpenter, and some of the people, his producers, and some of his casting directors actually didn't want anything to do with that. They didn't want the big flashy names of the time. They wanted more underknown, kind of up-and-coming actors, and that's how you got the cast that you got today. Funny enough, even Kevin Bacon was on the docket to play Arnie at one point, but he had to leave so that he could go do Footloose. Very, very interesting. But that's enough of a damn history lesson. Let's talk about the movie, the positives of Christine. Like I've already said, this is one of my favorite films by John Carpenter. I love his direction. I love everything that he injected his style into to tell this story. It's a cult classic, but it deserves to be a classic all around to me. To me, this film perfectly blends those strange and eerie tones of Stephen King's work with the style, the flash, and the ferocity of John Carpenter's directing. And honestly, King and Carpenter seem to have a bit of a synergy as far as their love for not only genre horror, but 50s teenager culture. I love the 80s movie flavor that this has with kind of a 50s movie skin on it. Two of the coolest and most iconic eras in not only film, but pop culture blended together in this nice, neat little bloody package called Christine. But beneath the directing is honestly just a really cool and great story. It's a really unique twist on demonic possession in a monster movie. And this is one of the few times that you have a tale of this big, larger-than-life supernatural entity, but it remains very character-driven and character-based throughout the movie.
Let me tell you a little something about love, Dennis. It has voracious appetite. It eats everything. Friendship, family. It kills me how much it eats. But I'll tell you something else. You feed it right, and it can be a beautiful thing, and that's what we have.
Honestly, the relationship between Arnie and his car, Christine, is bone-chilling.
You know, when someone believes in you, man, you can do anything, any fucking thing in the entire universe. And when you believe right back in that someone, then watch out, world, because nobody can stop you, then nobody, ever.
And you feel this way about Lee?
What? Fuck no! Talking about Christine, man! No shitter ever came between me and Christine.
The way that both Arnie and Christine really obsess over each other and protect each other and fight for each other and need each other not only really adds to that chilling aspect of their relationship, but it honestly makes you feel like together these two are unstoppable. They are an unstoppable force. No matter what one of them wants to do, the other one is gonna make damn sure that that is sought out. And I really like the aspect of the movie whenever things really start to kick into gear and the murders start happening. The mystery surrounding whether or not Christine itself is taking sole vengeance against all these people, or Arnie is actually behind the wheel of the car.
We could take it as a sign of fate. You'd have me to help you through the math courses and, you know, find...
Arnie? What's wrong? Arnie?
The movie does a good job at kind of hiding that and making you wonder whether or not it's one, the other, both of them. We have no idea, and it's a really cool mystery and a really cool element that really drives, no pun intended, the second and the third act of Christine. And this movie's got an awesome cast. You got Keith Gordon as Arnie, and honestly, the best thing that I've ever seen that actor do, the little bit that I have seen of him, he is the best performance in this movie because the entire cornerstone of the story and the depth of what is going on lands on whether or not this guy brings it to Arnie or not, and he totally brings it. He nails the duality of that character of being this really scared, twitchy, and submissive, nerdy teen that slowly starts transforming into this really dark and stern and reserved, sinister force. And his performance really adds a deep level of creepy to the car, Christine, and to the story going on, because you do see slowly the corruption of this character throughout the runtime as this car gets deeper and deeper into his psyche. You also have John Stockwell as Dennis, an actor that I have not seen very much of. I remember him mostly from this, My Science Project, and the guy that freaks the fuck out at the beginning of Top Gun. But he does really good at this as being kind of that guy who is the popular guy at school, the jock, who you can't help but like. He's not the typical jock that's trying to beat everybody up or trying to act like he's macho or beat up the little kid. No, he plays football, he's popular, all the girls are after him, but he still is a good guy. He's still a friend to Arnie, he's still a protector for Arnie, he still encourages Arnie and tries to tell him to get out there, go talk to her, do this, you gotta get out there. And I love characters like that because despite how many stereotypes movies of this nature try to tell you that there's either one side or the other, there's either the dickhead jock or the small, really innocent, beat up nerd, there are people in the middle.
Don't be scared.
I'm scared for you, man, for what's happened to you. It's this fucking car.
I know you're jealous. We'll always be friends as long as you stick with me. And you know what happens to shooters who don't.
No, what does happen?
Well, let's not kid each other, Dennis.
And honestly, it's mostly through his eyes that you see the transformation of Arnie as Christine and his obsession with each other get deeper. And it's through his eyes that you see most of the story unfold as kind of this guy seeing his friend, this guy that he used to love, that he used to have to protect, just get pulled into this darkness. Although there is one thing about his character that I will call complete bullshit on right now. There is not a script or an actor in the world that will get me to believe that you would pass over Kelly Preston to get to Alexander Paul. Sorry, not gonna happen. Alexander Paul is a pretty girl. Kelly Preston is a goddess. And speaking of Alexander Paul, this was actually her first major role before she went on to do Baywatch, and she does do really good in this, honestly. She does a really good job at nailing and making you believe the character of this really beautiful girl who is also very academically focused and not interested in being part of the whole popular girl clique and the popular girl trend that goes on in high schools. Another big middle finger to high school stereotypes in this character. But the star of this movie, Christine, baby. This car is both beautiful and terrifying. The concept of a machine that has a mind of its own is already scary enough that we've seen in many different incarnations, but the way that they portray it in Christine is just a new level of sinister for that type of storyline. And it gets to the point where just small little camera tricks and movie making tricks really make you believe that this car is alive. From the way that the headlights almost start to look like the eyes that Christine is looking at its victims through, even to the way that the radio plays and this really creepy green allure that kind of fills the car whenever Christine's trying to either get pissed off or try to communicate, and she communicates through 50s music. And I love the way that John Carpenter brought that car to life, because that's a concept that could be very easily silly when it's brought to live action, but through his camera work, through the score, through the way that he shoots in darkness and shoots the way that Christine kind of has these different quirks and these different things that make you feel like it's actually a living organism, totally brings that character to screen in the most effective way possible. And those regeneration scenes, whenever Christine gets all fucked up and she decides to repair herself,
Okay. Show me.
Among the coolest scenes of Carpenter's career, in my opinion. And funny enough, those regeneration scenes was a last minute decision by Carpenter. He wasn't gonna bother with it. He wasn't gonna bother transferring that to screen from the book, but in post-production, he did some reshoots and he used hydraulics to actually pull the car into itself. And then he plays the footage backwards to make it look like the car is pushing itself out and regenerating. Such a simple and cool trick, which is one of the things that Carpenter has always done in his career. And one of the aspects when you talk about a John Carpenter movie you have to speak on is the score and the soundtrack. I love the score to Christine. It's one of my favorite Carpenter soundtracks and scores, and it never gets mentioned. It blows my mind because it's one of his coolest and creepiest scores, and it totally fits what he tries to do in bringing Christine to life, especially when those tones hit, whenever the headlights come on.
Hey, Cunningham. Is that you, Cunningham? Hey, you ain't mad, are you?
Completely adds and intensifies the effect of what he's going for in those scenes. And as far as just the standard soundtrack, I love the 50s music that's sprinkled throughout this entire movie. Every time Christine gets pissed off and a 50s tune comes on, gotta love it. And the last thing that I really want to talk about with the positives is this movie has an awesome third act and a really good ending. Whenever you get to Darnell's garage and you have Dennis and Lee going after Christine, waiting to stop it once and for all, one of the coolest climaxes in any movie that I've seen as far as a Stephen King adaptation. It's really, really heart pumping. It's really surprising as far as how it kind of pulls the rug out from under you whenever Christine actually shows up. Such an awesome ending, and it really ends this movie with a punch. The only small negative that I have for this movie, which is a really strange negative coming from me because I'm not usually a source material pusher, there is an aspect of this story that they changed for the movie that I feel like would have worked out better in the end if they had kept it the way that the novel has it. And that surrounds the original owner of Christine, Roland LeBay. In the book, Roland LeBay is the one who actually sells Christine to Arnie. He's got a back brace. He has a lot of these things that he says and his dialect that Arnie throughout the story starts to kind of adapt. And as he gets consumed and kind of corrupted by Christine, he starts to take on the personality and even the kind of back brace and the hunch of Roland LeBay, the original owner, and it turns out that Roland LeBay is actually the one kind of possessing Christine and controlling it and corrupting Arnie. Well, in the movie, the car is just evil from the time that it begins. Whenever it comes off the assembly line, evil. From the very beginning. And while that is kind of a cool aspect, and I do love the opening of the movie, it kind of leaves some things unexplained that the movie kind of sets itself up to explain, because they show Roland LeBay's younger brother, George LeBay, and he's actually using a lot of the mannerisms and the dialect and even the brace and the look of Roland LeBay, so they kind of switch those characters, but in doing that, it kind of convolutes how Arnie is starting to talk like George LeBay and look like George LeBay and say things that he heard George LeBay say when George LeBay was never the owner of Christine. Like I said, small negative, and it's honestly something that probably 99% of the people who watch this movie will never pick up on, never see, and never care about, and that's totally fair. But now that I've seen the story of the book and I try to watch the movie, that's the one aspect of it I'm like, I wonder why they changed that, because if it was the way that the book had it, it probably would have worked out and gave the movie another small layer of creepiness. But nonetheless, that's it for my negatives. I love this movie. It's one of my favorite classics that I've grown up with. I constantly rewatch it. One of my favorite Stephen King adaptations, and like I've said, one of my favorite John Carpenter films, and you should check it out now. So if you haven't seen Christine, you're missing out on a classic. It's one of the coolest and most unique horror movies you can find, so absolutely go out and buy it. So what do you guys think of Christine? Is this one of your favorite Carpenter films or one of your favorite King adaptations? If not, put your favorite Carpenter film and your favorite King adaptation down below in the comment section while talking about Christine. And keep an eye out because I'm going to be reviewing Pet Sematary very soon. That's going to be my next review in this little Stephen King project I'm doing leading up to Stephen King's It in the beginning of September, which I'm definitely going to be reviewing. So please like and share this video, guys. Hit that subscribe button if you're not already a subscriber. If you want to check out my social media links, I got Facebook, Twitter, Instagram down below, and my Patreon page, which is a great way to support the channel and a great way to get exclusive content just for you, including the ability to choose the topic of a video for me to do, be it a movie review or a music review, video game review, a topic you just want to see me talk about, all of that exclusive patron content. Put all of your thoughts on the movie down below, and if you want to check out some more of my reviews, you can check out a few more by clicking right over here.